good morning, good afternoon, good evening. This, or it's 2 a.m. I messed it all up. This whole day has just been one giant freaking disaster in a freaking can. Because I tried to plan this out terrible. This is Eagle Eyes on Tech. I, of course, am Eagle Falcon. I am joined today with a special guest today, Mr. Regret the Van. How are you doing today, sir?
I am doing a lot better than some people I know or didn't know. You're introduced. You messed everything up. Yeah, no, work today started off really bad at work. So.
Well, I'm sure it was a lot worse than me just screwing up a line I've done now 56 times.
Let's put it this way. I really hope whoever gets that car is, they clean it up really well.
Well. Alright, so, yeah. Let's start off from the top. This was actually something that was, I actually found really fascinating. I don't know how many other people are going to. It was actually the crazy amount of camera tech they're using on tomorrow's Super Bowl. I'm not sure if you had a chance to look at this yet. But one of the things that they plan on doing on tomorrow's big game is that they've got a series of almost 100 high-definition cameras scattered throughout the entire stadium. And by using the angle and the recording point of this, they can simulate the sensation of a GoPro-style camera on any of the players at any time without actually having a camera on the players at all.
Okay.
That and it's...
Huh. Go ahead. That's actually kind of clever and actually wanting to see how well that works.
The demos they showed actually ended up looking extremely well. Even they ended up screwing around just a bit more and then superimposed like a faded out shadow of the gridiron just to simulate that you're looking through so-and-so's eyeball as not needed. But just kind of thinking about that, how many other sort of sports venues, et cetera, could see a lot, could use that sort of technology?
Well, you'd have soccer, baseball, basketball would be entertaining.
That's what I was thinking. That was what I was thinking too. Basketball would be interesting, to say the least. Just seeing from the angle of the of whoever's shooting the ball towards it, that could be absolutely fascinating. Hockey could be another really interesting one.
First person view of the fight on the ice. Okay. That's the first thing that comes to mind with hockey is going to be a first person fight.
Of course it is. Absolutely every time it's going to be the fights.
And that's going to be the big money. Like, I wonder how they would simulate, like, okay, and this player just threw a punch and the unfortunate player that just got hit just went down. Like, would they just kind of black the screen out suddenly and then have it come back up with, like, the normal perspective camera? That would be
They could. I suppose there's nothing really stopping that, really.
But the only thing that comes to mind would be the jump scare of the punch just colliding with the point of view.
I could see that being useful for a whole lot of, like, for the post shows and whatnot. That could be extremely entertaining for that. But otherwise, right in there, I'm not sure how quick this sort of setup that Intel's developed would work.
Well, if considering how cheap computing processing power has gotten, pretty much the mentality now is just bolt more cores on it. It's probably just, oh, we need more processing power. Just bring on more computers to do all that heavy lifting. So they could do that in real time and very cheaply at this point.
And then I think back to my own venture with this RealSense camera I'm using here and trying to make a green screen and how much of a disaster that was.
If you want disaster, it's just trying to green screen the background, my background. The best I could do is green screen one of the monitors to display something.
I mean that's all done on OBS's end, but the thing is that the Intel one, the RealSense, which is supposed to be a depth sensor, it added like a good 3 second delay to the capture, which then I had to delay the audio to compensate for that. And
Okay,
almost.
yeah, I could see how that would turn into a bit of a mess.
Yeah, it was just an awful, awful mess. So let's
And didn't
move.
you try that? Yeah, okay.
No, go on.
Didn't you try doing that with your T7400? Or was that with your new machine?
What I actually end up doing was, funny fact, Intel RealSense requires a Haswell or newer processor.
Okay.
So
So it's just.
I've got a Dell Optiplex 3020 with a Core i5 in it that's Haswell. Was doing the OBS capture on that,
Okay.
and then using a capture card to capture the Z800 actually gaming.
All right, which is, well, I eventually plan on getting a capture card for a little computer I call a toaster to do pretty much just what you're doing with that Dell.
So, in any
That's
case.
$35 I've ever spent.
Yeah, I'm still trying to figure out what to do with this $80 computer I bought that's now doing nothing. In any case, we're gonna move on to the next topic. This one. Nvidia including DRM on its bundled games. So this one, what Nvidia and AMD both tend to do is that to try and push sales of graphic cards, they usually do this during the slow season, usually during summer, where they'll say you could get a copy of this game or that game if you go and buy this card, or this card. Before, it used to just be a product code. You'd get the card, it would have the 20 some digit whatever scrambled letters and numbers, pop that in, there's your game, have fun. Usually they partner up with Steam on top of that.
If you go
Nvidia's.
back far enough, it actually was an actual disc that was included in the box with the card that contained the game on it.
Well, we're moving another step into the future where the new codes, you cannot even gift out the digital copies. Because the digital copies used to be through Steam, you could gift them out. Like, say, okay, I went and got a new Let's Live in a Fantasy Land. Let's say I got a new Titan X. And it came with a copy of, I don't know, what do we got? So some Gears of War 4. Why not? And it's just like, well, and seeing as how we clearly live in a fantasy land where I can afford that, let's say I already had Gears of War 4. And I'm like, oh, let me go gift it over to anyone. I'll do a giveaway. And just give it away. Can't do it. It is locked. And they're doing this through the GeForce Experience software now, as opposed to through Steam.
Okay. Now I always thought this that the giving away the game was always a bit of a gimmick. For example, when I bought my 970, it also included a download for Watch Dogs. Well, I'm probably not going to play Watch Dogs, so I never redeemed the code. This is not the first time I've had that happen, and each time it's just one of those, well, that's nice, I'm never going to play this game. Or set the code aside and forget about it.
But here's one thing that's starting to get on my nerves, and it's starting to begin a trend, or not really begin a trend, continue a trend. I really don't like, and that's the fact that it's NVIDIA providing the game through their GeForce Experience launcher. It is now yet another gaming launcher required on the computer to get games.
The video game industry, I've seen that they're kind of moving to that games not as product but as service. So you're not really buying the game anymore, you're kind of leasing the game.
Yeah, that's I hate bringing up this sort of phrase, but that's so 2012. We've been there, done that. Yeah, okay, we're now leasing games, it's all digital copies, blah blah blah. That's not the part that's getting annoying to me. It's the part where in order to be a PC gamer, I now need Steam, I now need Ugame, I now need GeForce Experience, I now need the Twitch launcher, I need freaking whatever piece of garbage EA has that's not worth mentioning. Then again, so is Uplay, so... It's... One of the things that I loved about being a PC gamer was the fact there was that freedom. There was the freedom of just going, this is how my interface is going to be. This is how I choose to be. Now, a lot of console gamers are getting an edge for the fact that they have a nice layout. We're very quickly losing that as PC gamers.
Huh, imagine that. That's getting turned on its head.
I know, what's up with that?
I had to actually something more and I just completely forgot.
Okay, that's fair. But yeah, the point I end up coming to is just, my God, please, for the love of God, stop pushing your own goddamn launcher. It's getting obnoxious.
I mean, one of the things that I'm always for is for competition. So if you can provide something that the other guys cannot provide, and you're a superior product, then I'm all for you throwing yourself out there. After all, take a look at what Netflix did to the cable companies. And it's proved that you can't get shitty service. You actually have to have good service. So I'm all for that, but this just is kind of one of those, here, have this. And it does feel kind of one of those trying to cash in, but not really putting the effort in.
I would much rather just see more games just say, you know what? Yeah, I'll go sell it on the Twitch launcher or Steam or whatever. But you know what? Here, just have it stand alone too. We'll just sell it directly to you. I would rather start doing that again and just customize my own start bar. I mean, right now I'm trying to keep my own launchers to a bare minimum. I think like minimum I have Steam, I have the Twitch launcher, and I have Orion, and I have Origin on here, but it won't work because Origin still insists that Eagle Falcon is a swear word and cannot be used as a username.
I've actually then got you beat because I only have Steam and Origin.
Oh, there you go. Well, actually, do you really? Well, I guess, yeah. You do beat me by half. I'll count Origin for me as half a launcher, even though I have nothing on Origin, because it refuses to let me create an account without offending me.
I mean, I don't have much in Origin, but I have, like, Star Wars The Old Republic, Sims 3, Sims 4, and I think Mass Effect 2 and 3 on it. And that's all I have.
And to answer Akane Owaribot, I tried. They won't let me use an underscore. They only let you use letters and numbers and spaces. I've even tried to break it down to see what part of Eagle Falcon offends them. if like LEF is like a French curse word or something. I can't figure it out.
It's just some idiosyncrasy for it. It's Origin. What do you expect?
Well, enough about Origin and also EA, who went and killed Commander Conquer on me. Let's move on to our next topic, and that is somehow in the world of the stock exchange, stockbrokers think that Snapchat, which is now going public, is going to be a high value stock, regardless of the fact that Snapchat has not made money.
All right, dot-com bubble again.
Yeah, no kidding. It's like I get Twitter, how Twitter took off regardless of the fact it didn't make money and the and it having a good IPO, but come on, Snapchat? The chat that specifically sells itself as the no ads, no records, no nothing, no worrying about us making money off you. How on earth does anyone think that's going to be profitable? And it sure as heck isn't going to be with those terribly ugly looking sunglasses.
Yeah, no, those sunglasses are awful. What I'm kind of thinking is they may think it's something like Facebook when Facebook went public, that it just went just ballistic, and I'm wondering if they think that Snapchat might be the same.
The difference is that Facebook had a plan to make money.
Data mining.
Then Snapchat loses their business model. Mean, at least Facebook had a plan. They said, look, every idiot is posting everything about themselves, and it's under our terms saying we can go use this however we choose. We have the plan to sell ads. Snapchat literally has nothing. They have less than Twitter. And Twitter's plan was tweet more.
God, I wonder how Twitter's stock is doing right now.
Let's find out.
That is.
It's almost like I have the internet at my fingertips. It's down 17 points. It's currently at $17.61. So, painfully below average.
Know, for
I think it's actually better than AMD's right now. Yep, it's better than AMD's. AMD is at
AMD
$12.24.
stock. Yeah, okay. Oh wow, actually, one of the random times for a while Google on my phone was providing a ticker tape for AMD
Oh my God.
stock, and I looked at it and went, oh my God, this is so depressing. And this was a few months ago. It was sitting around like $2. So that's, you know what?
They're still around $12. Judging by the history, it looks like they've stayed pretty consistent between $12.50 and $12. In fact, actually, over the year, they have actually been slowly going up.
Yeah, that's what I noticed because I said it was $2, 2 0
Oh,
two
you said two.
point
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. I
zero
misheard
zero
that.
dollars. Yeah, and I was like, wow, AMD, you've got to get your ass together because that's not good. So at least there's something there.
All right. Well, the chat has now confirmed that I'm an old grandpa at the ripe old age of 29,
Okay.
and that AMD's future, without a doubt, is still dependent on how well Ryzen does, and hopefully it will do something.
Yeah, blue screen.
If you work hard enough, anything can blue screen. I don't care how good the processor is. I'm pretty confident I can make my 6-core Xeon Abomination blue screen if I try hard enough. All right,
I
So.
don't think I've got my T5500 to blue screen yet.
Well, you're clearly not trying hard enough. I guarantee you, try hard enough, you can blue screen anything.
Well,
Like.
yeah, I throw an AMD card in there and it'll blue screen as soon as the screensaver comes up.
Or, you know, just. I don't know, just run something. But usually running Red Alert 1 does it for me.
I found that AMD cards don't like a particular OpenGL call that my screensaver makes. That'll sit there, run for 15 minutes, and then it'll just blue screen.
Oops. All right.
Yeah.
Let's move on to Mozilla to end development for Firefox OS. This should be a surprise to no one. I mean, Firefox OS pretty much was just the red-headed stepchild in a world that did not care what Firefox did. What is interesting, though, is the fact that Mozilla wants to shift over to connected devices, the Internet of Things.
Well, that is a well, if they can actually like do something neat over there and secure. Internet of devices things is really not secure, so if they can actually make it nice that it works all together and it's secure, then you know what? I'm okay with seeing Firefox OS die. Because if they can get into the IoT, then the botnet there goes away.
If only the great and all-powerful light bulb botnet would be killed that easily.
It won't.
There will always be some stupid manufacturer that would go with their stupid three lines of code to program their light-changing light bulb. And that is how the whoever the heck ha whichever nation holds the stupid hacker who came up with the light bulb botnet. I'm gonna say Canada because I don't want to feed the Russian hacker meme. It's that one can also seriously just please die. It's getting so old so
Yeah.
fast. But you know, as long as Mozilla is secure in what they're doing, I am super okay with it. Super, super okay with it. I just hope that the biggest thing that Mozilla does right for once, and I know they have a bad history of this, is to just make sure that whatever operating system they have their light bulbs and toasters run on is RAM efficient.
RAM's cheap. Just bolt more RAM on. Like, oh, well, we need more RAM. Here's another RAM chip. Boom, 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 boom. And now you have a light bulb with 16 gigabytes of RAM.
Yeah, I don't know if you can get 16 gigs of RAM into a light bulb. That'd be a challenge. Also, I would feel incredibly depressed that in the world where my phone runs the most inefficient operating system in all of existence, and it has less RAM than a frickin' Mozilla light bulb.
I would just probably buy it out of the sheer novelty of that this light bulb has more RAM than my phone.
That would thoroughly depress me. Not gonna lie. It really, really would.
It would be at a certain point, I would just sit there and just look at the thing and go, why does it need it? Whatever happened to just a regular light bulb?
Well, on one hand, a regular light bulb is only white. And on the other hand, your Philips, Mozilla, GE, whatever, multi-light bulb can change colors. Much like this next thing, the Thermaltake Tough Power Grand power supply also got infected with the new disease, which I absolutely do love PC Per for calling it this, the RGB disease. Because really, this is spreading like the plague. Everything now is being focused on being RGB and being able to change to whatever color it wants. And now it's even gone to a power supply.
Motherboard's next.
It's already done.
Well then.
Asus in particular is already doing RGB lights on their motherboards. They're calling it the Aura Spectrum. Complete with LED strands that hook up to the motherboard that allow you to control those as well.
What, RGB hard disks? Please tell me that hasn't been done yet.
Not that I know of.
Okay, good. At least I can sleep still.
However, if I forward this to who should I forward it to? Western Digital or Seagate?
Well, you could also forward it to SanDisk, Intel, any of the other companies. Samsung,
I was
if
going
they
to
make
say
SSDs.
Samsung. I'm trying to think who else makes SSDs right now. I forgot SanDisk exists outside of the world of flash drives.
SanDisk is the one that came up with the SSD.
I know, and look how little credit they got for it.
I know, it's sad, isn't it?
They got so little that even a nerd like me forgot.
Only reason I remember is that pretty much they're the pioneer, or were the pioneers in flash alt in flash memory altogether.
And now here we are. Everything is flash memory.
Everything's flash memory.
Everything is flash memory, everything is RGB lights, and everything will be soon be controlled by our light bulb overlords.
But anyways, back to the power supply, RGB power supply. The only use I could see that power supply being really in practicality would be for like a show computer.
Oh, absolutely. That's the only thing RGB is actually good for, is being a show computer, making some money back at the PAXes and whatnot. But let's be really honest. If you're going out there and you're getting a power supply like this, an Asus motherboard with a bunch of lights and whatnot, unless you're building your own case out of plexiglass and putting an aquarium in it too, you're not gonna make your money back at shows, and you're pretty much just doing this so that anyone who comes over to visit can go, "Ooh, pretty." And then that's
Now,
about it.
I'm also going to point something else out here. Power supplies traditionally have very limited communication with the motherboard. Pretty much, only two wires tell the from the motherboard tell the power supply to start up. For that thing to have communication with the motherboard, so it can tell the LEDs what to do, there's now an extra path in there that should the power supply fail catastrophically, now there's a potential path for it to go straight to the motherboard and do just more significant damage to the board.
Yeah, that's one thing I noticed the article didn't talk about was how it communicates. I don't know if it communicates those LEDs through the primary 24-pin connector, if there's another sub cable that connects to a USB header that it communicates through, or what the story is, or if it's all just self-contained and there's a switch you have to flip somewhere on it for it to switch through the various modes, which I can only imagine how much of a pain that must be.
Then you'd only do it use if it's said like the dip switches, then you'd only do it as like a themed build, like I'm going to do blue lighting or to keep my temperatures down, or I'm going to do green lighting for economy and the whole color spectrum joke included.
To which then I have to put Unjust Banana in the chat's concerns at ease and say I'm pretty confident there's not going to be a power supply botnet. Pretty confident that's not going to happen.
That we know of.
Oh, please. They're going to go after the actual computer itself before they go for the power supply.
The power supply, yeah. That being said, the power supply could be a point of an attack vector, but yeah, no, it's not likely.
It would depend how it's connected. Again, if it's a self-contained sort of thing, then it's not going to be connected to the internet, and therefore it'd be a closed system, and therefore basically impenetrable. But enough of that nonsense. Let's move on to... Oh, I guess we'll move on to the HoloLens. Which I'm once again reminded still exists. It's like this thing pops up once a year to just go, remember this thing that wowed you a while back? We're still working on it. But in the thing is that unfortunately, I mean, it's out there. It seems like we're getting closer and closer to this augmented reality dream and or nightmare to actually happening, but you thought the cost of entry for the Oculus was high.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
I just read the cost of entry for...
You
that.
Just
that
saw
is
it.
High.
And the thing is, that's just the headset. The cost of entry is being estimated, not even confirmed, at north of $2,000. And this isn't
yeah,
even...
They have... At the bottom, they have it listed in pounds, so you'll have to do a conversion. But they have developer only at £2,179 and an enterprise version for £4,529. So break out your calculators for freedom units.
Well, my calculator that I'm holding in my hand is actually a power supply tester, so I'm gonna go out of my price range.
four, five, 29.
Plus, I just can't see myself needing that. Like, at all. Plus, what kind of rig has to power that? I mean, we still don't know if it's self-contained, or if it's gonna need a high-powered rig to do the computing for it. So, you know, add another grand and a half to your cost of entry, assuming you don't already have a high-powered rig. And I mean, like, really high-powered. Like, even what I've got right now is not close. Unjust Man is also correct. $10 is also out of my price range. Actually, I don't know. Maybe for $10 I would try it.
For $10, pretty much... What's the risk? And an hour's worth of work, if that. Yeah, I'd throw down for 10.
Although, if what Unjust Banana says is confirmed, I really want to know what the markup is, because there's roughly about $10 worth of CPU in there, supposedly it's using an Atom.
Well then, that's, actually, I bet what they'd be using the Atom for is to talk with a, bigger machine somewhere else.
I believe that. I have a hard time believing that one little 2.5 watt Atom is powering the whole thing.
Yeah, no, I think that Atom is just serving as a front end to pretty much do everything. It might also do local stuff. So like, I don't know if the HoloLens has like voice recognition. The Atom may be processing that too.
Maybe. The thing is, well, the unfortunate thing is that this is all speculation because the article doesn't say, and it's hard to find any other articles that confirm anything. Literally anything. It's all speculation at this point. It's just resurfacing because we now have prices and confirmations that it's still a thing that's being worked on and is not a myth.
Yeah. It will be very interesting when it actually does finally hit the market, as some of Microsoft's recent projects have actually turned out really, really amazing. I would really love to actually own a Surface Pro 4.
Well, to be quite
Interesting to
honest,
see what.
I would be more interested in the Surface Studio than the Surface Pro. As much as I do like that tablet, I mean for what the Surface does best, that Studio, that all-in-one, much nicer. That 27-inch monster. All right. If you got nothing else, then let's move on to this other semi-comical end result of a lawsuit between ZeniMax and Oculus. Now, I didn't have a chance to look at this too deeply, so I'm not sure of all the details, but basically, what the blasted thing sounds like is that it sounds like a development pissing match between ZeniMax and Oculus, both of which were VR companies, and just Oculus got their stuff out the door first. And ZeniMax tried to say that Oculus violated some of their patents, which sounds like potentially the patents might have been invalidated because of the filing dates, but it's almost irrelevant because ZeniMax won the lawsuit and was awarded $500 million from Oculus.
Okay, I'm actually reading a bit more into the article. According to this decision, the jury believes that ZeniMax has some ownership over Oculus's trademark and source code copyrights. They
Oops.
also believe that, again, according to the verdict, which was posted by Ars Technica, Oculus violated a non-disclosure agreement that caused the $200 million in damages to ZeniMax. In the future. And okay, like I'm looking at this going, okay. First off, who at Oculus did not notice that this code might have been owned by or copyrighted to ZeniMax? But it's that one's hard to say. It depends on how much it's like. Are they claiming that it's like one line of code is there, or are they claiming an entire segment of code is theirs?
It's hard to tell in the grand scheme of things. And I think it's more of, maybe Oculus figured out, between 1 to 5 lines might have been so close that it would count towards this. And one thing I was re-reminded of this morning when I was doing prep, that Oculus is owned by Facebook. So in the end, 500 million in a payout to make these idiots go away? I'm pretty sure Oculus is more than happy to go, okay, fine, here's your check, now go away forever, please, thank you.
Pretty much, that was what it looked like. 500 million, that's chump change for Facebook and Oculus at this point.
Well, especially since one of the stories I left out, because it was kind of one of those stories where you're just like, okay, here's the headline that says it all, let's move on. Was that Facebook just broke like 8.9 billion in revenue this last quarter.
Why am I not surprised?
You shouldn't be. That's why it wasn't a story. So it's just like breaking news, Facebook makes money hand over fist to the surprise of no one. This concludes the story. Exactly. It was more fascinating to me that this company that just came out of nowhere is just like, we're important.
Now, and related to Oculus, I actually did recently actually get to try an Oculus on.
Oh, really?
Yes, the local Best Buy had a vend had apparently an Oculus vendor there doing a demo, and I got to play with the unit for a little bit.
BRB, guys.
And
No, I'm kidding. Running the
they're not there. I was well, they might be there. It was one of the larger Best Buys in the area, but I was actually kind of impressed with the unit. Actually doesn't feel that heavy.
That's actually surprising. I expected that thing to feel like 5 pounds.
No, it was actually pretty light. The controllers were decent. I would have really have liked to played with those controllers a bit more, but it is actually surprisingly how immersive it really was, and I'm a skeptic of VR. I kept trying to walk away from the demo because I was playing the rock climbing demo.
Now, are you
So
sure that it was because of how immersive it was and not because, well, hey, look, free headset. It's attached to my head.
no, there is actually a cable. It's a significantly long cable.
Yeah,
But
I know.
it just
There's two, if I'm not mistaken, one for power and one for HDMI.
yeah it but they're very closely wrapped to each other
Okay.
so that they don't get tangled up. You can still see that there were two, but it was just you could count it as one. But the rock climbing demo is like, okay, I'm trying to climb around this cliff, and so I'm trying to move my body to follow around this cliff, and I ended up walking away from the demo. And the poor guy went, no, you have to come back here. It's like, oh. So, about the only thing that I had to complain was that once I took the headset off, it's like, oh, reality just doesn't measure up.
Reality just doesn't measure up. It's because we don't have Minecraft in reality yet.
No,
All right,
we
I want to
don't.
address one link that Unjust Banana just dropped in the chat, and that is a report from The Verge, supposedly confirming that the HoloLens is using an Atom chipset, which is supposedly a quad-core Atom processor, 2 gigs of RAM, and 32 gigs of internal storage. I am a little reluctant to believe this.
That just okay. The way that looking, it's like, okay, you have the quad core Atom, the 2 gigs of RAM, and then 32 gigabytes of storage. That just sounds purely front end and local interface only.
Give me a second, I'm looking up the exact specs of the Atom chip they're claiming. The Atom chip they are claiming is the X5Z8500. This is a 2015 chip. So already this sounds like a preliminary report or the specs for a prototype than it is the actual one, because I can't imagine that in 2017 this would launch with a 2015 chip in it. That's a 2-watt chip, base clock speed 1.44 gigahertz, 4 cores, 4 threads. Burst speed of 2.24. Maximum memory 8 gigabytes, dual channel. Here is where I think there's no way on earth that it's going to come even close to what it needs to do. Because the one thing that's actually really, really necessary for VR is the graphics horsepower. The graphics horsepower on this particular Atom. Integrate Intel HD graphics, no surprise there. Base clock 200 megahertz, burst clock 600 megahertz. Video graphics max memory, which is shared, maxing out at 8 gigabytes, so it has to share from the 2 gigabytes that's on there at DDR3 speeds. And extension units 12.
Yeah, I'm looking at that, and for like HUD stuff for ARG for the augmented reality, this could do. But the full VR, I could see that this would just fall flat on its face so fast. You'd get a load screen and then you'd go into a slideshow.
Here's the thing. This would easily be able to handle some of the menus that the HoloLens uses. There is no way on earth that a GPU like that is going to do something like render a Minecraft world onto a table.
No, like I said, well, okay, yeah, I have to agree with you on that one. The HUD type stuff. So like the compass and the menus, yeah.
The menu is showing the time in the corner, things like that, or you have a new message. Here's a new email. But there's no way on earth, because they were showing the thing rendering a large chunk of a Minecraft world onto a table and showing characters moving within the Minecraft world game in real time with the HoloLens.
Yeah, that has to be communicating with something to make that happen. So a bigger machine somewhere not on camera that has the actual graphics horsepower to do it, so.
Let's move off from VR altogether. Let's get to possibly one of my new favorite power supplies for high reliability builds. I've talked about this power supply before, but now it is in fact real. It is no longer a rumor. The FPS Twins 500 watt redundant power supply and 650 watt redundant power supply. Redundant power supplies, you may or may, well, I know you regret the van know what a redundant power supply is. The listener may not. A redundant power supply means that in the back of the machine you have two power connections. You plug them both in and they both provide power to the system. When one fails, the other one instantly in real time takes over and covers the load. You can then replace the section of the power supply while the machine is still running and be back up to full capacity again. This is used commonly in server environments. Occasionally, you see this sort of thing in mission critical workstations for like oil research. But these lunatics over at FSP went and designed this sort of high-end commercial grade stuff in a package that can be used by anyone doing PC building. And that's the part that's absolutely fascinating about this particular power supply.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now and just how small each of these quote power supply units are to deliver 500 watts. Those things are going to be actually quite toasty if you get them into full load. I would actually want to get my hands on one of these power supplies just to tear it apart, just to see how they made it tick. Because 500 watts in what effectively is a 2x2x6 space, that's a some pretty impressive packing.
If you actually move down further, they actually do have a pretty decent in-depth teardown. They haven't torn down one of the individual PSU bricks, but they do get it down and show the power relay system that's combining the two into the redundant things going on here. One thing I'm noticing actually is that it's got to be an internal fan in the middle of the PSU. Because I'm not seeing on eat wait, no, I lied.
Yeah, at the ends where the cable
Yep,
comes out.
I just saw the screws. I
Those
lied.
little
I
fans are going to be screamers.
found them. Actually, I don't know, because those actually look like they're pretty small bearings. It doesn't look like the it doesn't look like the server deltas I usually see in these suckers that would end up having this thing sound like a vacuum cleaner.
Well, if the power supply is built smartly, they're going to be speed controlled. So you're only going to hear them sound like a vacuum cleaner on startup, and then they're immediately going to drop down to idle. But just to displace that much heat in that small of a package, those fans are moving a lot of air.
Oh, no question about it. And I'm sure I'm pretty sure they're using a dual board system. One's got some of the ingredients up below, some have got some high. And it's probably specifically placed out for optimal airflow, which is common with redundant power supplies.
Your Sun Micro systems, in which case your power supply is the size of a shoebox. And completely passive on the inside.
Well, Sun Micro system also puts 32 processors at 800 megahertz in 2010, so, I mean, they're their own special breed of, we're going to do things our way, and goddamn industry standards.
Pretty much.
Though I'm not going
to... For the record, I never got that server to come online. It resolutely refused just to power on.
I'm not going to lie, some of their bigger... I forgot what they call them. Some of their bigger rack servers, which they have a special name for them, and it's something that it sounds like a fifth grader would come up for his new race car. Those things are absolutely fascinating on the inside. But, I was going to say something and now I forgot it. Let's just move on to... easily
stop depressing ourselves.
The biggest question that nobody asked in all of history: does mayonnaise last as a thermal compound? I want to meet whatever idiot asked this question first. Unjust Mayonnaise actually mentioned half of it, and I just remember the other half of it. Ultra Spark. That's what it was.
Yeah, that does sound like a name some fifth grader would come up. I'm gonna have to take a look at this machine.
But in any case, like I said, the question nobody asked: how long does mayonnaise last as a thermal compound? I did not know that this was a thing. Did you?
No, I did not know either.
What else can you say?
I just kind of just go, well, if you want your computer to smell like a sub shop, then by all means, go ahead.
I am pretty sure a sub shop is going to smell better than mayonnaise cooked at, what's my processor at right now?
Probably idling somewhere in the 50 to 60 C range, so...
You are correct. It is at... The cores are ranging between 57 and 53 C.
Yeah, so it's going to be cooked. It's not going to smell terribly good, and I'm going to guess once all the moisture is cooked out that it's going to quickly fall apart, and you're going to lose all thermal conductivity other than just what you get through sheer contact.
Oh, really? I'd have no idea.
I think this was just somebody being bored and screwing around with a processor that they had on hand. And it's like, well, let's try this. it worked.
I'm trying to pull up the test they had, and it was actually comical in the fact that...
Okay, I'm reading the article. It says, amazingly, it worked nicely, proving to be, at least a short-term, better thermal compound than several well-known commercial products. But at the time, we could not determine how long it would continue to work before a degradation in performance was noted. This time around, we ran long-term tests to determine if mayonnaise can last as a thermal compound.
Here's a spoiler. It doesn't. The thing is that the mayonnaise it up, I just screwed myself. And their tests after like day three was when it started degrading. And that was about when the mayonnaise became cooked completely. And it then also started causing a bit of corrosion between the copper block and the lid of the processor. And they've actually got some pictures of that right here. I'm putting up
Yeah,
on the stream here.
that's some pretty impressive corrosion there. Given what's in there, it would probably turn potentially turn vinegary. It'd turn into a weak acid, which against copper, copper is very reactive to acids, even very weak ones such as vinegar. It would start trying to eat that stuff away.
Well, it did.
That heat thing's ruined.
Yeah, and the saddest thing is that actually, let me bring that back up again. I think that's a water cooling block that they just ruined.
Well, actually, it depends on how much the acid, how much it's actually damaged. I was also looking at that, going, well, if you carefully take a soft wire wheel to it, you could probably get that to smooth back out.
And then you gotta hope that it still that you don't, because they usually don't give you a whole lot of extra metal on that thing, and it's not like with a lot of those latches that you can just screw it on tighter to make solid
Yeah.
contact.
Thing is that I don't think they would go too thin because I don't want it that it that that you could easily rupture by just misaligning it and having it scratch on something.
Oh no. I mean more shaving off that fraction of a millimeter to smooth it out. You might not make solid contact at that point.
Yeah, you would need proper thermal grease and you're gonna have some hot spots.
And
Yeah, but
possibly more
hey.
than normal.
So yeah, that's a very much a good possibility that even with getting it back down, it's not going to be proper. So yeah, that's a trashed hot water, trashed cooling block.
And that's a shame, but at least we have our we now know
For
you
science.
can use mayonnaise as a I don't know why anyone would do this.
I can't think of it either, but someone tried.
Someone tried, someone did. That's about all we can say. That's gonna do it for us today after talking about mayonnaise as a thermal paste. So, my name is Eagle Falcon. I of course do variety Twitch streaming here, twitch.tv/eagle_falcon. Regret, go ahead, promote yourself.
Is regret the van? Yep, regret the van. I also do random streaming at regret the van, regret underscore the van, the underscore van at twitch.tv.com. I just probably screwed that all up. In fact, well.
twitch.tv/regret_the_van. You can find them over there. That's gonna do it for us. Thank you everyone for sticking around with us despite all of our unique difficulties today on all around, me especially. Please do follow this podcast, whether it be on YouTube or on Podbean. Take care, everyone. Rest well. We'll see you next week at 3 o'clock Central Time. And if it's not going to be that, we'll update on Twitter. Take care.